Hi, I'm Natty and I'm the Yogi.
And I'm Michelle and I'm the Blonde.
And this is the Yogi and the Blonde podcast.
In this podcast, we offer guidance,
motivation,
education,
and inspiration
to help you adopt healthy habits you can sustain for life.
If you enjoy the podcast and would like further information,
head over to our Instagram or YouTube pages.
You can find the links in the bio.
Hello.
Welcome. You sing us in, Michelle. Welcome.
Welcome to the Yogi and the Blonde.
Da-dum.
Having a bit of playful time.
We're happy because the sun is shining. Yay. It's amazing what a difference it makes to your mood when the sun shines.
No,
when
such,
you've been
such
denied it for such a long time. So yes,
with some heavy crazy rain that's flooded things my place,
yes,
and various people and kindergartens and workplaces and
yes,
so it's
we're
good
happy
to see
the sun. It makes me want to sing.
Well, it does change. Well, vitamin D is you get from the sun, and that affects your mood.
Excellent.
Right,
yes.
So it makes sense. Anyway, what we're talking about, but you think about this, this is going to go good because we are talking about energy out. And what does the sun do? It creates energy.
It's the life force of all energy. All comes
so,
from the sun.
It makes sense to be in such a good mood on a Sunday, on a sunny day, not Sunday, but on a sunny day.
Sunday.
Can I have the weekend, please? It's only Friday. I want to have the weekend. And it's all about the energy in, energy out, man.
Yeah.
Let's do this. Okay. So today we are going to talk about energy in, energy out. I'm going to tell you guys of what I learned of a definition of energy in, energy out.
You've been geeking out.
Yeah, I'm geeking out a little bit. And then Michelle is going to talk to us about the law of thermodynamics. And then we're going to talk, Michelle and I are going to have a bit of a discussion of our own experiences with clients about how that affects our body composition. So that's what today is about. And that's what it's about. So if you've never heard what energy in and energy out, if you've never heard that expression before, this is what it means. Energy in, energy out is a basic principle in the thermodynamics, which Michelle, tell us more about, that refers to the balance between the energy consumed, what we eat. So that is creating energy for our body. And it's anything that comes into the mouth, okay? By an organism or a system, and it's the energy it expands. So for those that are watching, you'll see me, I'm talking with my hands. So I'm expanding energy. And just before this episode, I had some food. So I was consuming energy. That's a pretty good one, isn't it?
I like that. Yes. Energy in, energy out.
Yeah. Okay. When I was like doing my geeking out thing, tell me a little bit about thermodynamics.
The law of thermodynamics. Yep. So when we talk about energy.
Just a sec here. What do they call it? The law of thermodynamics.
Because it's. Because if you go against it, you're going to get arrested.
Ooh, I heard the best joke of a line from my client. I'll tell you another time. Okay. I'll tell you when we're done. Never mind. It's not the right time. But anyway,
no, it's a scientific law. It's like the law of gravity. I think it's something that is science. You can't.
It's a science thing.
You cannot go against this. This is the law.
It's proven.
Like the law of gravity. It's proven. It is. That's it. The law.
Like the law of attraction.
Exactly. So don't try and come at me,
okay,
is what it's saying.
Okay.
So the law of thermodynamics relates to energy. So energy cannot be created. You can't make energy happen. It has to be transferred transferred or transformed from something else. So it's converted. So it's funny that we were talking about the sun, actually, because the sun is so hot. It provides energy to the earth. Things grow. We eat those things. And those things within our body systems, we turn into energy that we expend. So
we can expend because they are live organisms. Because what we eat, even plants, they're alive, right? Because they need water, they need sun, they need all of that. So they are also alive. They might be not talking and speaking and have a beating heart and blood, but they're still alive organism. That's why it says organism or system.
Yes. Exactly. And where do things grow? Because of the energy from the sun, through a process that we all learned at school when we were kiddies called photosynthesis. Do you remember learning about photosynthesis? We had to draw like leaf cells.
Oh, yes.
Draw the little cells.
Draw about leaf cells, yes, but I didn't
realize that. Yeah, because we dissected leaves. Photo, I can't even say it, photosynthesis. Oh, dear. Photosynthesis.
Hey, you're doing better than me, girl.
Thanks. Thanks. We'll get through this. Photosynthesis. So that's So that's the process of the sun coming into the plant. The plant takes the energy. Mm-hmm. The plant grows. And like I said, we eat the plants. We take that energy. It comes into our bodies. And then our bodies go through processes to use that energy.
Mm. And then so it's, like big animals like bears and lions, they eat us for energy for them.
Exactly. The circle of life. The circle of life.
Part of the circle of life.
So you can relate it to the circle of life, where the energy is just moving around between us. It can't be created. It's transformed or transferred from somewhere else.
It's just like the ocean. There's energy in the ocean. Everything's got energy, actually.
Energy, everything's got energy.
There's energy in the air. There's energy in the water, right? There's energy in our drinking water, actually, is alive. Like when it comes from the plastic bottle or it comes from the tap and it's so fully killed by chemicals, it's not live. But I'm going to... my medical machine of water, because I'm a water snob, that is alive. So
so there we go. Energy in places you least expect it. So the reason that that is important is because we, as you already mentioned, we consume energy and we expend energy. But when we relate that to body composition, which of course we do, we're personal trainers, we're in the health and wellness space. Basically, you have to use the energy that you're consuming. Otherwise, your body is going to store it. If it's not used, it's not going to disappear into thin air. If you consume more energy than you are expending, it's going to be stored in your body until a time when you can use it and it can be transferred to energy to be used. So this is why it's relevant to this conversation. We're not just randomly talking about scientific laws, but it's important to know about this cycle because essentially this is the basis of how to lose fat.
Yep. And if you, we've got another episode about NEAT, and this goes with NEAT as well.
Yeah.
So we kind of are playing around with our podcast episodes. So the kind of, you learn from one and then move on to the other
bit
that all kind of coincide together, right?
Yeah.
And so when you think about the movement you do, then you're burning off that energy you've consumed.
Yeah.
And there's different types of energy as well. There's nutrition energy, and this is when we're talking about food and what kind of food you're eating and your different macros. And then there's empty calories, which give you energy, but not the right kind of energy.
I'm going to disagree there.
Okay.
A calorie is a calorie. A calorie is a scientific term. A calorie is a unit of energy. So when we're talking about energy, a calorie is a unit of energy.
Which
your body
is what you're
doesn't
consuming.
Know. Yes. It doesn't know if it came from an alcoholic beverage or a spoonful of sugar or a grain of rice. Like yes, it's the calorie right. is that's a calorie. Correct. So
yeah.
The term empty calories, kind of disagree with a bit. I know where you're coming from because of course
empty calories in the fact of lack of nutrition, maybe yes. nutrition value. Yes. So maybe I'll say definitely. That rather than a yeah. calorie. When I say an empty calorie, I'm talking about lack of nutrition.
Lack of so nutrition. Yeah.
Lack absolutely. Of nutrition with that empty calorie. So
yeah. And you know, this is a slight tangent, but
that's okay.
We could go, and this is another podcast in itself. When people label foods good or bad, you yeah. know, that can be quite a toxic place to lead into. And yeah. really what they mean is some foods that are more nutritious have a better nutritional content than value, other foods. Yeah. That's yeah. what we're talking about, whether something's nutritious or not. And you can relate that to calories. You're going to have your calories. You're better off getting it from your nice whole grain, happy food that's packed with nutrition, vitamins, minerals, micronutrition. You're better off getting it from there than you are from a shot of whiskey. But yeah. whiskey has calories in it, yeah, but they are calories and they will still be stored in your body if you don't expend them.
They are non-nutritional values.
Correct.
They are empty nutrition.
Empty of nutrition.
Yeah. Because this also goes back to, I'm thinking about when we learned about, when we were talking about the vegetables, about different types of vegetables, of like you got your fresh vegetables, you got frozen vegetables, and we were talking about budgeting, what is most the value and everything. And then we talked about processed food, and that's when you did some geeking out and learned about there's the processed, ultra processed, and what was the other one? Was that it? Just processed,
it was culinary processed,
processed,
minimally processed, processed, culinary processed, processed, and ultra. Processed.
And some of those processed foods were actually not bad processed foods.
Yeah. It's just quite nutritious. Yeah.
They're not whole just been... foods because yeah. they were just broken down. It's like, yeah.
yeah.
So it's that same kind of thing of when you think about the energy you consume can be a ultra processed energy. That would be a yeah. good one to say, wouldn't it? An ultra processed energy would be that whiskey, would be the fast food, that kind of thing, wouldn't it? Mm. Because it's still energy consumed, but it's ultra processed. It's
yeah. But when we're real. Looking at energy balance, kind of irrelevant of the nutritional factor, because actually that is an important thing to come back to. And this is something that you've experienced yourself, that you can be eating a very nutritious diet, but actually you can probably be consuming more calories than you're actually expending. So it can go both ways. So it's yeah. it's an interesting yeah. point to hold on to.
Let's tap so, into that while we're in it, yeah. Michelle, to be honest.
Well, because... So if we talk about the calorie, the energy balance, so based on the law of thermodynamics, if you are consuming energy, it's used and transferred to something else, like what I'm doing now, moving around,
yeah.
or it's stored. So we would have, and it changes every day depending on what we're doing, but you've got a rough calorie balance, I guess, your maintenance, where you consume pretty much what you burn and your body composition will stay the same.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. If you are in a position where you are over consuming calories, so you're taking in more calories through your diet than you are expending, that energy is going to stay on your body. It's going to be stored, and it gets stored as glycogen in your muscles.
Yeah.
And then when that's full, it gets stored as body fat.
Yeah.
And this is when we start to see our body composition change and we start to gain weight.
Yeah.
When people want to lose that excess fat, that yep. stored energy, if you consume less than what you need, because your body has to get it from somewhere, it turns to its storage systems. And that's when you start to lose body fat, because you're not consuming enough to sustain your body for what it's doing. And it has to get it from somewhere else, because you can't make it. It has to be transferred. So it takes the stored energy, turns it into usable energy, and then that's how you lose body fat. So by manipulating your energy
in
consumption, and also
your energy out,
aka need, by influencing your energy expenditure, you can play around with your body composition and lose fat if that's your goal, or gain muscle, gain size if that's especially your goal.
Yeah, because if you're increasing your protein intake, or you might be increasing your workout, you're increasing your neat factor. And then because if you want to grow muscle, you're going to have to increase your intake as well.
Absolutely.
So, but you still want to, if you want to keep low in the body composition, you still need to be eating less than what you expend. Just because you increase your expenditure doesn't mean you got to increase your intake to match the expenditure. So what I found is as well, and this is something I've learned through my own journey, and this is what Michelle is talking about, is I eat pretty freaking well. I eat pretty good. Michelle's tried some of my food. She loves it. But it's how much I'm eating, how much. And some of what we eat has higher calories than other things. So blueberries, I can eat I can eat a shitload of blueberries. But it's really low in calorie. But if I start eating lots of avocado, that's going to be a higher state of calorie. Not just because it's fat, it's just the calorie base. Makes sense? Because the blueberry would be more of a carb base, but it's still lower in calorie. It's not saying that carb is always lower. It depends on what you're eating. Everything is different.
Well, carbs per gram are 4 calories. Just protein per gram is 4 calories. Fat per gram is 9 calories.
Yeah.
And alcohol per gram is 7 calories.
Wow. So it's almost the same as fat. Makes sense.
Yes.
If you're drinking a lot.
And this is, I guess, where the low fat movement came from back in the 70s, which actually was not necessarily the right approach, because just because fat has more calories, it doesn't mean it's bad for you. And this is why in all of the healthy eating guidelines, we're encouraged to minimize our fat. Because you're absolutely right. You can eat a punnet of blueberries and the calorie content will be low in comparison to you eating a punnet of avocado, because the calorie content of the avocado is quite high. It's not to say avoid it because it has a higher calorie content, but it's to be aware of that in terms of how you're fitting that into the rest of your wider diet.
And that's going to be a good other discussion as well, is talking about the macros and the different differences with macros and the nutrients of learning about that. Like, it's interesting because I like Michelle and myself, we both use an app, and I'm sure some of you guys might be already using it, which is My Fitness Pal. And it's where you enter in of what you're eating. So then you have an idea of what you're consuming. So you're within that frame of your energy in, and you know with what your energy out. So Michelle has a Fitbit, right? And does that talk anything about how many calories you're expending as well?
It does. Yeah. Okay. I always take that kind of thing with a pinch of salt. You're in a ballpark.
Yeah. I've got an Oura Ring, and an Oura Ring that it's quite scientific. And it like reads your temperature. So it helps. So I'm aware of where I am for my cycle because of the temperature, where you're reading your site, where you are for temperature and all that. So, maybe a little bit more accurate than a Fitbit, because it is on your finger. And when you go to the hospital, when they put the thing on your finger, that's where they're reading for your heart rate, all of that. And that affects your calories. It knows what your calories are being burnt. So I don't say it's exact the same, but it's probably a little bit more accurate. But I do look at it, and I do notice when I'm not moving much, I see a big difference, you know. I see quite of a big difference. And I see, even there's some days I walk more, but other days I walk less. But it depends on what kind of exercise I do that day, I'll be expending more energy. So there it's quite fascinating on just seeing that as well, of how that is. And this is where it's not something, it's a bit dangerous when we've got these apps, like I've heard people comment, you know, about having apps, and they're like, oh, my app said I should be resting, so I'm not going to go to the gym and stuff. This is, again, it's not It's not the law. It's to help you just keep in control of knowing and giving you knowledge of knowing what you're doing. Now, it's the same thing with MyFitnessPal, where you're entering your details of what you're consuming to know what you're consuming for your expenditure, to make sure if you want to be in that deficit to be able to lose that weight. So that is something to use as a tool, not to say, oh, I've gone 200 grams, 400 grams today. That's okay. Every day is different. So, and because that's something that, you know, I've been unwell and obviously my expenditure hasn't been normal. But I was noticing, because I have a coach, everybody's got a coach. It doesn't matter who you are. That's another subject we are going to talk about one day. And I was just saying, I said, oh, I've been going over 400 cals than what you're giving. And he's like, that's fine. He's like, just try to keep bringing it back down. And he's like, plus you got to think your body's been unwell. So you're feeding it, you're resting, you're fueling, you're doing what you need to do to help support your body. Cause even though you're sick, your body is working quite a lot. Your organs are working quite a lot, trying to detoxify and get rid of this sickness in the body. So it is working. It's not like as much as if I'm moving, but you still need to support that and nourish it. So that's why, you know, you got to fuel yourself when you're sick. You know, you don't deprive yourself, because if you start depriving yourself from fluids, from food, then your body's coming into a stress point and it's already stressed. So it's that balance of making sure you're nourishing yourself. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So it's just, it's fascinating. So now, is there anything that you find that your clients or yourself, even from your own journey, Michelle, that you found that you struggled with this whole energy in, energy out?
There's quite a big misconception in the wellness space, that people say, oh, well, actually, no, I'm overweight because of insulin. I'm overweight because of this. I'm overweight because of that. And countless studies always come back to that, whether you're eating a high carb diet or a low fat diet, or a high fat diet and a low carb diet, if your protein and your calories are matched, you will lose body fat if you are expending less, if you are consuming less energy than what you are using. So I think, you know, companies try to, it can be very confusing for people, I think, because you're hearing all of this stuff on Instagram and it's like, oh, but no, and you've got diets that are like, this is the best diet. And it's like, well, no, this is the best diet. And everybody's had their great experience on their diet.
But is it sustainable is the other thing. This is why I'd rather eat macro base for your body and for what you're wanting to achieve rather than a specific diet. And you can work a diet around that macro base easily and the calories. But again, it's about eating what works for you. Like one thing I love this saying is, one person's food is another person's poison. I know my body can't. Quinoa is a super grain. It's great. It's great for people who are gluten-free, and it's a great option. It's got a plant-based, it's a high carb plant-based, but it also has some protein base in it. Great for those that are also vegan or vegetarian, but my body doesn't break it down. So it does not work for me. So it doesn't mean it's a bad thing either. So it's just,
I don't really care about macros. I care about protein and that's it. And then everything else can take care of itself. Yeah. Protein is the only macro that I will track to ensure that I'm eating enough. Where my fats and carbohydrates fall, I don't know. Because, you know, like I said, you can eat high fat, you can eat high carb. Doesn't matter. If you're trying to lose excess body fat, then as long as you're in a calorie deficit, then that's the most important thing.
I'm going to counteract that actually in the way of counteract it in, that is what works for Michelle. like what Michelle's talking about, this is what her goal, this is her focus. That's why it's about individuality, right? So there's not, you just got to focus on all three. And that's what I want. I want just that more balance. That's what I want. Michelle is focused on more protein, and she's not wrong. I'm not wrong. It's about bringing down the calorie and increasing your expenditure. Now, but saying in that, I wouldn't bring it down to like 1200 calories a day, because you would be like the worst, moodiest, horrible person, and your body would be in stress because you'd be in that much deficit.
And for most people, 1200 calories is below their basal metabolic rate, which, if you've listened to our other podcasts, you will know is the amount of energy we need just to exist. So for a lot of people, they go on these super low calorie diets, and they're not actually supporting their own bodily functions, which mm-hmm. often just that severe restriction leads to an over restriction. But it, just coming back to tracking macros, you know, a lot of this depends on the level of detail that you are willing to go into. And
that's right.
You are a coach. You're very interested in this stuff. You like to educate yourself. For other people, even tracking their calories can kind of take them down quite a toxic path.
Yep.
So kind of suggesting, you know, make sure that you are making better food choices and looking at your portion sizes can still be a really quite easy way of maintaining or losing excess body fat without having to go into that real strict detail. If you're a bodybuilder taking part in a physique competition, then you are going to be looking at every single gram of carbohydrate, every single gram of fat, every single gram of protein. And that's part of the prep to be a bodybuilder. But for a kind of general person, they might be like, this is way too overwhelming. I don't need to know this. So if you can encourage someone and say, well, let's check that you're at least having 100 grams of protein a day. That's a random figure I've just pulled out of my ass. Let's at least check that. And then it makes it kind of a bit more achievable and a bit more easy for people that don't find this stuff as interesting as we do.
Yeah. But again, because we have no idea who's listening, it's always good to make sure we touch base on all aspects. And it's all about what I find when I'm coaching and teaching is that if there, just pick one thing. You don't have to resonate with everything. There's going to be a lot of information. So if you pick one thing that resonates with you, that's all that we are looking for. And that's my goal. Michelle, I'm kind of speaking for the both of us. I don't even know if that's what, how you go about it, but that's for me. If somebody, because it is overwhelming when you look at health and wellness in general, there's a lot of information. So if there's one thing out of all the podcasts that you listen to ours, to whoever, there's one thing that you focus on, learn about it, understand it, then learn the other parts of it and go with what feels right for you, what resonates with you. And that's why I was really honing in on Michelle's focus is protein, and myself, I like to look at all three macros because it's not a right or wrong thing. But then again, for some, you might just use your hand and fist as a protein measurer, right? For a female, it's one. For a male, it's two hands. For one female, it's your hand. And it's even a thickness as well. So it's just a little something for you to think about. You're thinking that you need to get an app and all this stuff. This is something that I also teach people is like, it's up to you to decide. I'm going to give you tools and information, but it's, and I can help and guide you. And, but you know your body best, you know how you work best, which one would you be more successful with? What is more sustainable? That's the better word. What is more sustainable for you, right? I love these apps. I love doing all that thing, but that's where I'm at. Michelle, you don't use the app as much. You did at first, but you don't anymore, do you? Because you're just more focused on the protein.
And I think this is the whole thing about when it comes to, understanding energy balance when it comes to weight loss. A lot of, not to throw shade on dieting companies, but big companies like Weight Watchers, Slimming World, they don't educate their clients on how this law of thermodynamics, how energy balance works. Mm. They label foods with random numbers. They call some foods sins, which is toxic as in itself. So people go on these programs, they follow the rules, they lose weight because essentially what the diet has done is put them in a calorie deficit. Mm-hmm. But then they finish, they're like, yeah, cool, I lost 14 kilos, success. That was a great diet. But then they haven't learned how to then adjust their eating habits to ensure that they can maintain that weight loss. They know how to follow these random made up rules mm-hmm. and they do that successfully. Fine, you've lost your weight. But then you have to understand the calorie content of what you're consuming and how it relates to energy balance and how you move yourself, what you do with yourself. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you're just going to gain that weight back. And I think when you're using an app instead of following one of these random programs, pay attention. Like, pay attention. Don't just log it and go, cool, I'm aiming to hit 1800 calories each day. Yep, done that, done that. Pay attention. Pay attention to what you're putting in. Pay attention to the meals that you create and eat all the time. Like, I don't need to put into my app to figure out what calories are in my breakfast. I know what calories are in my breakfast because I was tracking in my app for a long time and I was paying attention. I know how many calories are in a banana. I know how many calories are in an egg. You know, I don't need to check on Google or put it into my app, because when I was doing that process, I was paying attention and learning. And, you know, this is information that is helpful. A lot of people will say, don't go on apps, they're bad for your mental health. But it's information. It's all information. Absolutely. It's information. Yeah. I want to know how much energy is in what I'm eating. One of the saddest things I realized was how energy dense peanut butter was. One tablespoon of peanut butter is 120 calories. And that's not even a heaped tablespoon. That's quite a flat tablespoon.
It's not much for me. I think.
And that's good to know, because I can just boop, 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 spoon it out. And, you know, you can have 600 calories of peanut butter that hasn't filled you up, because it doesn't have a big food volume. It's just like, yum, this is nice. You might send yourself into a calorie surplus with that. So it's good to know these things. It's good to know. I actually need to be mindful of how much peanut butter I'm putting into my smoothie, because actually it's got a lot of calories and that could flip the balance. And even though it's a healthy thing.
Again, like the avocado and the blueberry, both of them
absolutely.
Are healthy, right?
You've and got some things thing that are nutrient dense.
Yeah. Like I would like smither my gluten-free bread with it and stuff. And it's like a good source, good quality gluten-free bread. And I smither. And when I started doing the calorie counting and learning more about my macros and stuff, I was like, when I do the measurement, I was like, holy crap. Shit. No wonder why because I'm 45, my body's changing, hormones are changing. I put on some weight and I'm like, what the fuck? Why is this? I eat really healthy. Well, what's going on? And it's because I'm eating too much of high dense calories.
And this is it. Density is a good word, because you've got some foods that are calorie dense but low volume. And then you've got other foods that are high volume but low calorie. So peanut butter is a perfect example. Avocado is a perfect example. Things that have a lot of calories for how much actual physical space they take up. So you're not going to sustain yourself. You're not going to feel satisfied if you had 3 spoons of peanut butter as a meal.
Yeah.
Whereas you might have a massive bowl filled with salad leaves that has big volume, but super low in calories. You might chop up a load of cucumber, celery, carrots, you know, have a really massive salad, and it will have less calories than this tiny little thing. So that's more likely to make you feel satisfied, make you feel like you've eaten a lot, versus having something so tiny. So I think having that education helps you to move forward and make better choices. So you might say, do you know what? Yeah, I'm going to really fancy that cake out for coffee with your girlfriends. You might know, yes, cool, that's got quite a lot of calories. For dinner tonight, I'm maybe going to rein it in. I might just have a chicken breast and a nice big salad.
Instead of
spaghetti bolognese. So it helps you, having that education helps you make choices to balance it. It's not saying you can't have these super high calorie foods. It's saying learn how many calories they have so that you can fit them in, enjoy them, but balance them within your whole diet. And this is why people talk about a balanced diet.
Yeah. And that makes sense. That I love how you put that. You put that very well. And it's been such an amazing eye opener. Now, hey, Michelle, let's put it in the notes down below about what you spoke about, how, what was the calorie for a carb, for protein, for fat, just to educate people so they have something to start off with. And then from there, people can start becoming aware and going, okay, this is blah, blah, blah. And then also maybe we should put down, you know, just the link of what the app is, the MyFitnessPal, just some ideas for you guys to start looking at some research. And I'll give you a calculator as well, because MyFitnessPal, when it does the calories for you, it's actually quite low. I notice it's really super.
Yeah.
So I'm going to, there's a website where a calculator, and you actually put in the things like what you want to lose, all that kind of stuff. And it spits out. And it depends on your age, if you're male or female, all that kind of stuff. So we'll have those down below as well. So then we've got, so you've got some tools there. We're giving you guys some tools.
Yeah.
Tools. So trying to remember and look it up. We'll have some information down below in the notes for you guys for that. So let's wrap it up to that, Michelle. You've like, it's been great. Like energy in, energy out was today. It's been amazing learning both of how it's not one thing. It's not one size fits all. So that's finding what works for you, your lifestyle, what is sustainable for you, what is your passion, what do you enjoy? Like, I know my one sister hates cooking, so it's not her thing. But then you come to me and my other sister, we love cooking. So it's, do you know what I mean? So just find what works for you. And even if you find there's nothing wrong, and I think Michelle, you do this as well, is you have certain recipes, you know how many calories, whatever it is, and you just stick to those. Just, there's nothing wrong with that. Because I know you do that quite a lot, don't you, Michelle?
I do that a lot. Yeah.
Yeah. And there's nothing wrong with that.
That's how I've maintained my weight loss. Yeah.
And it's, you enjoy it. And again, there's nothing wrong with it. And I like to experiment.
Yeah,
and nothing's wrong.
And then you can give those things to me. And it's
well, there
you
is
experiment,
some...
and yeah, I will test them.
Michelle's my taster, my taster. But that's us for today, guys. Thank you for joining. Now, don't forget to like us, to follow us, to subscribe, comment down below, share us on your stories. Let us know what you like. Let us know your takeaways from these. We'd love to, and tag us. Don't forget to tag us as well. We'd love to hear how, what you guys are thinking. And again, comment, let us know what you want to know, what you liked, what you didn't like. And that's us for today. This was Energy Out and Energy In with the Yogi and the Blonde. And yeah, we'll see you guys next time.
Bye.
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 Hello. If you have enjoyed listening to our podcast today
and want to hear more, please subscribe using the button below.